Karanam Chintamani Prakara Sadma Sukalpa Vriksha Lakshavriteshu Surabira Pipalayantam Lakshmi Sahasra Shatasam Ramasevya Manam Govindamari Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Venum Kunantam Aravindam Dalaya Taksham Bharavatam samasitam buddha sundarangam Kandarpakoti kamaniya vishesha shobham Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Alola chandra kala sadvana balya vamsi Ratnangadam pranaya keli kala vilasam Shyamam tribanga lalitam niyata prakasham Govindamadi purusham dhamaham bhajami Angani yasya sakalendriya vritti manti Pashyanti panti kalayanti chiram jaganti Ananda chinmaya sudujvala vigrahasya Govindamadi purusham dhamaham bhajami Advaitam achyutam anadim anantarupam Adhyam purana purusham navayovanam cha Vedeshu durlabham adurlabham atma bhaktau Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Pantastu koti shatavatsara samragamyo Vayoradhapi manaso munipungavanam Sopyastiya prapadasimnya vichintya tatve Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Ekopya saura charitum jagadanda kotim Yashakti rasti jagadanda chayaya dantaha Andantarasta paramanu chayantarastam Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Yadbhava bhavita diyo manujasta taiva Samprapya rupa mahima sanayana bhushaha Suktaryameva nagama pratitaistu vanti Govindamadi purusham dhamaham bhajami Ananda chinmaya rasa pratibhavitabhis Tabirya eva nijarupa taya kalabhihi Goloka eva nivasatyakilatma bhuto Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Primanjana churita bhakti vilochanena Santaksadaiva hridayeshu vilokayanti Yam shama sundaram achintya gunaswarupam Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Ramadi muti shukala niyamena tishtan Nana avatara makarod bhuvaneshu kintu Krishna swayam samabhavat parama pumanyo Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Yasya prabha prabhavato jagadanda koti Koti shvashesha vasudari vibhuti bindam Tad Brahma Nishkalam Anantam Ashesha Bhutam Govindamadi Purusham Dhamaham Bhajami Maya Hiyasya Jagadanda Shatani Sute Traigunya Tad Vishaya Veda Vitaya Mana Sadvavalambi Parasattvam Vishuddha Sattvam Govindamadi Purusham Dhamaham Bhajami Ananda chinmaya rasatmatayama nashu Yapraninam pratipalam smarutam upetya Lilayitena bhuvanani jayatya jastram Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Goloka namni nijadamni chaleta tasya Devi mahesha haridama suteshu teshu Te prabhava nichaya vihitascha yena Govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami Shristi stiti pralaya sarana shakti reka Chayeva yasya bhuvanani viparati durga Ichchanu rupam api yasya chacheshta tesa Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Shiram yatara divikara vishesha yogat Sanjayate nahitata pratagasti heto Yasham bhutam apitata samupaiti karyad Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Departure eva hirashantanam abhyupetya Dipayate vrivata hetu samana dharma Yastadrigeva hicha vishnu chaya vipati Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yakara narnava jale bhajatisma yoga Nidramananta jagadanda saroma kupaha Adhara shaktim avalambya paramsma murtim Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yashaika nishvasita kala matavalambya Jivanti loma vilaja jagadanda nata Vishnur mahansa iha yasya kala vishesho Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Bhasvanya tashma sakaleshu nijeshu tejaha Siyam kiya prakatayatta vitadvadatra Brahmaya esha jagadanda vidana karta Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yat para pallava yugam vinidaya kumbha Dvandve pranama samayesa ganadi rajaha Vignan vidhantum alamasya jagatrayasya Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Agnir mahi ganganamam mumurudhashascha Kalastatat mamanasiti jagatrayani Yasmad bhavanti vivavanti vishanti yamcha Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yachchakshuresha savita sakala grahanam Raja samasta suramuti rashesha tejaha Yasyagnaya brahmati sambrita kala chakro Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Dharmota papa nijayashutayasta pamsi Brahmari kita patagavada yascha jivaha Yadatta matra vibhapa prakata prabhava Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yastvindra gopa matavindra mohosa karma Vandanu rupa palabhajana matanoti Karmani nirdahati kintu chapakti bhajam Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Yam krodha kama sahaja pranayari bhiti Vatsalya moha guru gaurava sevya bhavahi Sanchintya tasya sadrishim tanamapurete Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Govindamari purusham dhamaham bhajami Sriya kanta kanta paramapurusha kalpataravo Drumabhumishchintamani ganamayitoyamamratam Kataganam natyam gamanamapi vamshi priyasaki Chiranandam jyoti paramapi taraswadyam apicha Sayatra shiradvi sravati surabhibhyasya sumahan Nimeshardhakyo vavratati nahiyatrapi samayaha Pajeshweta dvipam tamahamiha golokamityam Vidantaste santakshiti virala chara katipaye Ato vacha mahavishnur bhagavantam prajapatim Brahman mahatva vignane prajasarge chachinmatihi Pancha shlokim imam vidyam vatsatatvam nibodame Prabhu de jnana bhakti vyam atmayananda chinmayi ude tunutama bhaktir bhagavat prema lakshana pramanais tat sadacharais tadabhyasair nirantaram bodhayanatmanatmanam bhaktimapyutamam labhet yasya shreyaskaram nasti yaya nivritum apnuyat yasarayati mameva bhaktim tameva sadayet Narmananyan parityaja mamekam bhaja vishvasan yadrishi yadrishi shraddha siddhir bhavati tadrishi kurvan nirantaram karma loko yam manuvartate tenaiva karmana dhyayan mam param bhaktimichyati ahamhi vishvasya characharasya bhijam pradhanam prakriti pumamscha mayahitam teja idam vibarshi Vide videhi tvamato jaganti Ishvara parama krishna sakchit ananda vigraha Anadiradir govinda sarva karana karanam Iti sri brahma sanghita sampurnam Hari om. May I have one of those books? Welcome everyone. Good morning. Hare Krishna. I first offer my respectful obeisances to my spiritual master, His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, and to all the devotees who are present here today. You're all Vaishnavas, and therefore the most revered of all the living entities in the universe. Hare Krishna. And it's such a nice taste here early in the morning. It's not so early, but it's the morning time anyway, to recite notable verses, which is one of the devotional processes. Anyone can feel revived in their spiritual life by coming in contact with spiritual sound, because there's a resonance with the soul, the Atma, that is Sakchidananda in nature, because soul is part and parcel of Krishna. And so therefore, qualitatively, has the same properties as Krishna, who is Sakchidananda. And when the Satchidananda soul comes in touch with spiritual sound vibration, he feels revived. Revived from what? From being stifled by hearing material sound vibration. That is, those topics and vibrations which pertain to making oneself comfortable in the material world, by avoiding pain or trying to find some arrangement here one way or another to find happiness. And even within the Vedas, there are such proclamations as perform certain sacrifices to attain heaven. These in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Traigunya vishaya veda nistraigunya bhavarjana nirdvanvo nityasatvaso niryoga shema atmavan. Don't, Arjuna, take part in these. They relate to the material world. Beyond the utterances of the Vedas, which have their place, ultimately, and it's a bigger conversation, there are the Upanishads, which talk about that which is beyond the material nature altogether. And they ask us to take a look at the difference between matter and spirit. One of the ways in which they do that is to say, look at yourself and see how you're different from matter. And when you see that, you can also see the nature of God, because God is distinct from matter as well. And you're a small sample of him. So by looking at the sample, you can understand something about the whole. Beyond the Upanishads, we have Srila Vyasadeva giving a summary of all the Upanishads in the Vedanta Sutra, and showing what their conclusion is, because sometimes people misunderstand that the Upanishads are telling us that you are God and that you should try to become God by removing any of the material coverings and then realizing your eternal identity as God, which has been lost. And there are many arguments to counteract this fallacy of logic, which I won't go into at this particular time. But after the Vedanta Sutra, Srila Vyasadeva gives the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is a natural commentary, meaning it's a commentary by the author himself on a particular work that he's done. So the Srimad Bhagavatam then gives the ultimate conclusion. For instance, in the Vedanta Sutra, janmadyasayataha means that the Supreme is that from whom everything else emanates. And that Supreme is mentioned again, that source of all emanations is mentioned again in the beginning of the Srimad Bhagavatam at the very outset, janmadyasayataha. And following that this is a natural commentary on the Vedanta Sutra, but then the very nature of that absolute truth is described in great detail. In fact, in the first rendition of the Bhagavat Purana, the exact details of the Supreme Personality of Godhead were not given by Srila Vyasadeva, and therefore he felt morose. And when he felt morose, what did he do? He went to his spiritual master. He said, I've done my duty as well as possible, but now I don't feel right. What's wrong with me? Please detect what's wrong with my service and tell me how to adjust it. And Narada Muni, his spiritual master, said, problem is you haven't spoken directly enough about Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For that is the way in which one becomes cured from one's attachment to material nature altogether. And also, he said, in compiling the Vedas, you've given a lot of opportunity for people, a lot of alternatives for people to misinterpret the purpose of life, thinking that it's actually meant for adjusting oneself in the material world for happiness. So he said, be more direct. And after Srila Vyasadeva took this instruction and went into samadhi and personally saw the pastimes of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he then gave us the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is described as the Amala Purana by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the spotless Purana, the ultimate authority on everything, and the pinnacle of spiritual life, also described within the literature itself as the fruit of all the Vedic literature. Nice to have that, isn't it? But not only that, that fruit has been blended. It's now not even in a fruit form, because sometimes you get a fruit and go, oh, it's too hard. And maybe it's too hard to eat because there's seeds, there's a peel, and so forth. But this fruit, as mentioned in the beginning of the Srimad Bhagavatam, has already been rendered into a semi-solid form, kind of like a smoothie. You like smoothies? I know I do. So you can drink it. It's a beverage you can drink. And the implication in the outset of Bhagavatam, Nigama Kalpataro Galitam Palam Shukamukadam Rita Dravasamyutam, that Pibhata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam, drink this rasa, Pibhata Rasam, drink it, and what do? When you drink it, you become intoxicated. Not the normal kind of intoxication where you wake up with a headache, but this is the kind where you actually feel connected with the Supreme Personality of Godhead and exhilarated from that. And then one passes out from that spiritual intoxication. And when you wake back up again, what are you supposed to do? Drink more. And on, you're supposed to drink the nectar of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So by taking the verses of Bhagavatam, one can actually enjoy life. And this Sri Brahma Samhita, which we chant regularly, is a literature which is non-different from Srimad Bhagavatam. It describes the personal pastimes of the Lord. First, it describes his abode. Because in the Bhagavad Gita, we hear from Krishna, na rupamasyeha tatopalabhyate nanto nachadir nacha sampratishta ashvaram suvaruda mulam asanga shastrena dridhena chitva tatapara tatparimaragitavyam yata yasmin gatana nivratanti bhuya tameva chadyam purusham prapadye yatak praviti prashrita purani. Let's try it one more time. Na rupamasyeha tatopalabhyate nanto nachadir nacha sampratishta ashvatamenam svaruda mulam asanga shastrena dritena chitva tataparam tat parimargitavyam yasmin gatana nivartanti bhuya tameva chadyam purusham prapadye yatak pravriti prashrita purani. And that is that Krishna says, we're entangled in a world that is like a gigantic banyan tree where one cannot understand the beginning or the end or the form. And one has to cut down that tree with a strong weapon of detachment. And thereafter, search out that original Supreme Personality of Godhead from whom everything else has emanated, and there surrender to that Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that's our mission, should we decide to accept it. And the Sri Brahma Samhita gives a very clear target. What is the spiritual world? What does it look like? Where is it situated? What are the details of the very seat on which Krishna, the object of our meditation, sits with his consort, Srimati Radharani, in the spiritual world? All these details are given so that one can actually fix one's mind. And if one doesn't have this specific information, then the Srimad Bhagavatam says, Rikta Matayo, the mind remains empty, and that's dangerous. This saying in some English poem or literature that idle hands are devil's workshop, and Prabhupada rendered that idle mind is a devil's workshop. And if you leave them idle, then you leave the mind idle, which means that if you don't have a specific object of meditation, the mind, because of its past experiences, some scars, impressions that it has from previous touches with the material energy, will decide for you. And that's not a good idea. Because if you leave the mind to its own devices, it will eventually drag you down into a place that you don't want to be. So Krishna recommends in the Bhagavad Gita that one control one's own mind. And how? Manmana bhavamak bhakto, think of me. So I'll just give one sample from the Sri Brahma Samhita about how one can meditate on the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. And this comes in the first verse in which Brahma is describing what he's seen in his meditation, from verse number 29. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, the first progenitor who is tending the cows, yielding all desire, in abodes built with spiritual gems, surrounded by millions of purpose trees, always served with great reverence and affection by hundreds of thousands of Lakshmis or gopis. Purport. By the word Chintamani is meant transcendental gem. Just as Maya builds this mundane universe with the five material elements, so the spiritual chit potency has built the spiritual world of transcendental gems. The Chintamani which serves as material in the building of the abode of the Supreme Lord of Goloka is far rarer and more agreeable entity than the philosopher's stone. You know what that is? Philosopher's stone? Does anybody have one in their purse? In your car? Philosopher's stone is stone that fulfills all your desires. If you touch another object with it, it turns into something very valuable. Right, Karuna?
Yes.
Thank you. The purpose tree yields only the fruits of the piety, wealth, fulfillment of desire and liberation, but the purpose trees in the abode of Krishna bestow innumerable fruits in the shape of checkered divine love. Kamadhenus, cows yielding the fulfillment of desire, give milk when they are milked. But the Kamadhenus of Goloka pour forth oceans of milk in the shape of the fountain of love, showering transcendental bliss that does away with the hunger and thirst of all pure devotees. The words Laksha and Sahasrashata signify endless numbers. The word Sambrahma and Sadra indicate being saturated with love. Here, Lakshmi denotes Gopi. Adi Purusha means he who is the primeval Lord. Here we have the sense for the unlimited nature of the spiritual world and Krishna's preeminence there. And if one studies these verses and understands the particular aspects of the spiritual world and of Krishna, then one's mind finds a resting place where it can feel complete satisfaction. I think that I'm going to have to move again. No. You have to put somebody have to get on the roof and put a blanket over it. I can go this way too. That's better, right? We'll be right back, folks. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Janna Ballabha Girivara Dhari. Gopi Janna Ballabha Girivara Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Gopi Jana Ballabha Giri Varadhari Gopi Jana Ballabha Giri Varadhari Ishodanandana Vraja Janaranjana Dashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana Dashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana Jashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana Junatira Vanachari Jamunatira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari
Jayam Vishnupad Paramhamsa Parivraja Kacharja Stotaras Dishishiman Abhay Charanada Vinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada Ki Jayam Vishnupad Paramhamsa Parivraja Kacharja Stotaras Dishishiman Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai Ananta Koti Vaishnavinda Ki Jai Nam Acharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai Premsa Gaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Garad Hara Shivasari Gaur Bhaktivinda Ki Shishi Radha Krishna Gokopinath Shama Kund Radha Kund Giri Govardhan Ki Jai Shri Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai Shri Mayapur Navadip Dham Ki Jai Shri Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai Tulsi Devi Bhakti Devi Ki Jai Jamuna Devi Ganga Devi Ki Jai Sambeda Bhakti Vinda Ki Jai All glorious assembled devotees All glorious the assembled devotees All glorious assembled devotees Gopre Manande Haribo Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya Narayanam namaskritya Naram chaiva narottamam Devim Sarasatim Vyasam Tato Jaya Mudiraye. Before we begin the Bhagavatam class, I'd like to welcome my dear friend, wonderful devotee, Harinama Prabhu, who's come all the way from Amsterdam to join us here at ISV. Please welcome.
Hare Krishna. For those of you at home, he said he's really happy to be here. Thank you, everyone, for coming out this morning. It takes some effort to move physically across the planet. That's why this world's called Durga, means difficult to go. And there's a lot going on in everyone's life, so to actually come here to be part of the live studio audience is an austerity, and I thank you very much for taking the time. And for all of you who have tuned in online from all over the world, we thank you very much for giving your attention. We feel it. We know you're there. We feel it. Consciousness goes beyond the personal presence. Just knowing that you're there inspires us to be here in this yajna-stali, this place of sacrifice, to perform the best of all sacrifices, which is to hear about Krishna from the Srimad Bhagavatam. And for any of you who are here for the first time, we heartily welcome you to this place. We're very serious about what we do here, which is to follow in the footsteps of the previous acharyas or teachers who have chalked out a path for us to the best of our ability, adjusting only to time, place, and circumstance in order to make the message more appealing so that people can understand the context and take up the practice of bhakti yoga. Today we'll read from the Srimad Bhagavatam, some related philosophical points that will come from the Srimad Bhagavatam. But the title of today's class is that your heart is a bank account, fill it up. And it's important to remember because we may be motivated. Everyone's motivated. That's the nature of a living entity, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. Nahi kashchit shanamapi jatu tishchatya karma krit karyate hyavashak karma sarva prakriti jayargunai. And living beings are always active. If you look under the ocean and look at all the fish under there, and there's all kinds of creatures down there, they all have a little chip in the game. They're all doing something to move forward their own little agenda, whatever it may be. So they have impetus, they have volition. Every living entity has that. It's the nature of the living force. And the Srimad Bhagavatam teaches then that there are ways in which we can act that give us great fortune, spiritual good fortune, which is the only real fortune. In fact, Bhaktivinoda Thakur talks about various kinds of fortune that one can get. One is related to karma. Karma unmukhi sukriti means that one can become more and more qualified for instance, building things here in the material world and making oneself comfortable. There's practically no limit to that. In fact, if you look at some of the houses people build around the world, they're sometimes featured on special shows where they say, look at this house. You can't imagine. It's got 42 rooms, 36 bathrooms, 10 swimming pools, and so forth. And then the poor guy's never home. The dog's home looking out the window like, look what I won. And so on. It goes in the material world that whatever arrangement one makes, one never quite gets to enjoy it fully. It's always elusive, always a step ahead. And then there's qualification that one can get for jnana. That is being very insightful and seeing how the material world's divided into various elements, how there's a difference between matter and spirit, and ultimately coming to the conclusion that one should retire from the material world altogether and having that impetus very strongly. Some people have that. You can notice that some people retire from the material world altogether and say, how do they do that? They got some qualification by association, previous life or this life. And then Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that the highest wealth that one can get is called bhakti unmukhi sukriti, which means a qualification for bhakti. That means a propensity to associate with bhaktas, with devotees, an appreciation for devotees. This is the first symptom of devotional proclivity, is that one wants sadhu sangha. One sees devotees and thinks, what they're doing is a good idea, and I'd like to do it too. So I'm going to go spend time with the devotees. And even one molecule of this impetus for devotional service is considered to be, and proclaimed throughout the scriptures, to be of the highest benefit. So if one can stock one's heart with such an asset, then one becomes the wealthiest of all people. So that is where we keep our treasures, in our heart. And as we keep various items in our heart, we then act out in this world in various ways. Because as Ramananda Roy says, the heart is the driver and the body is merely the chariot. And we only go where our heart dictates. Someone may say, I knew the right thing to do, but my heart told me otherwise. Someone instructed me to do this, but my heart told me to go the other way. And ultimately, we do vote according to what's in our heart. So how does one get that asset? How does one increase it? This is the preoccupation of the transcendentalists who are connected with Shukadeva Goswami, Srila Vyasadeva, and the parampara coming down from Lord Krishna. They are as greedy as any materialist, in fact, more. And this greed, Rupa Goswami says, for this spiritual wealth is the main qualification for spiritual life. Krishna bhakti ras bhavito mati kritam yari kritopi labhyate tatalolyam api mulyam ekalam janmakoti sukritir na labhyate. So you can't get this, he says, after millions of births of practicing pious activities. There are various pious activities mentioned in the scriptures that you can become more qualified for karma and jnana and so forth. But this kind of spiritual wealth, he says, comes only when you have intense greed for it. Tatalolyam api mulyam ekalam, and this is the root cause of devotional service. And furthermore, he says that if you know that bhakti is available, this kind of spiritual wealth is available somewhere, you should go there immediately. Don't wait, don't hesitate, don't say, I'll do it after I finish my education, don't say it, I'll do it later in life, but you should go immediately once you understand the value of this. And it's in that move to get it that Krishna empowers one with intelligence, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. Those who have this impetus to get this pure love for God are empowered by me personally, Krishna says, to know how to find it. That's why there are amazing stories of people with obstacles in front of them who found their association with devotees through a circuitous route. They somehow or other came across, went through all the obstacles in their path because Krishna gave them intelligence at every step, how to come to the devotees. And we can't tell where this bhakti is going to spring up. One may prejudge based on one's own estimation of who people are. My friend Divyanga Prabhu, who goes on book distribution practically every day, was telling me this morning that when he was out distributing books, and recently from ISV, we sent him some Bhagavad Gita's to distribute. And he's very happy about that. He said, Vaish, anyone I come in contact with, they get a Gita. So he said, when he comes to a stoplight where there's a homeless person begging, he waits till they come to the window, and then they come up and they say, you know, can you give me something? And he looks around and he goes, oh, you know, I have three teenage kids, and I don't have any money right now, but here. And he gives them a prasadam lollipop and a Bhagavad Gita. So a very downtrodden looking, disheveled man who was begging at the light a couple days ago came up to the window, and he gave him a Bhagavad Gita and a lollipop. And the man looked at it and goes, oh, Bhagavad Gita, yeah, I needed this. And then he said, by contrast, he was in a parking lot and a man was driving a $165,000 automobile. And he showed him the Gita and he said, oh, I'll never read something like this, take it back. And one cannot judge a person's actual wealth by their external appearance. The scriptures and the great devotees judge by the person's impetus for pure devotional service or for attraction to scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the main calculation. In fact, Rupa Goswami lists various qualities of pure devotees. And then after listing 24 qualities, 26, 24, 26, he says, if 25 are absent, but one quality, which is the propensity to surrender to Krishna and the impetus to do so is present, then that person's counted as a devotee. All the other 25 can be completely absent. Because if that one quality is there, the scriptures say, somehow this person got some wealth. They're in the game. And because of that, as they pursue it, that desire for association with devotees and the practice of devotional service, all other good qualities will come naturally. Yes, yasti bhaktir bhagavatiya kinchana sarvar gunas tatra samasate sura harava bhaktasya kuto mahadguna manoratina sati davato bihi. The great overture of 5.18.12 from the Srimad Bhagavatam says that by this mood of surrender and endeavoring for devotional service, from whatever lowly position one starts from, one will be infused gradually with all the good qualities of the devas. Or another interpretation given by the acharyas is that as one takes to the process of devotional service, one develops such good qualities that even the devas will want to come and live in your house, because they aspire to live with the devotees, because it's such a noble and valuable kind of association to associate with devotees. So, from the Srimad Bhagavatam, today we'll start by looking at a verse from the fourth canto, which is a little off the beaten path. You may not know this verse, but once you hear it, you wish you did know it. This is from Srimad Bhagavatam, fourth canto, 22nd chapter, Prithu Maharaj meeting with the four Kumaras. And it's text number 23, 422-23. Atindriya Rama Sagoshya Trishnaya Tatsamatanam aparigrahena cha vivikta rucha paritosha atmani vina harer guna piyusha pana. I'll say the word for word, please repeat. Artha, riches. Indriya, senses. Arama, gratification. Sagoshti, with their companion. Atrishnaya, by reluctance. Tut, that. Samatanam, since approved by them. Aparigrahena, by non-acceptance. Cha, also. Vivikta rucha, disgusted taste. Paritoshe, happiness. Atmani, self. Vina, without. Harehe, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Guna, qualities. Piyusha, nectar. Panat, drinking. Just from the word for word, you know something good's coming, right? You can feel it. One has to make progress in spiritual life by not associating with persons who are simply interested in sense gratification and making money. Not only such persons, but one who associates with such persons should be avoided. One should mold his life in such a way that he cannot live in peace without drinking the nectar of the glorification of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari. One can be thus elevated by being disgusted with the taste for sense enjoyment. Purport. In the material world, everyone is interested in money and sense gratification. The only objective is to earn as much money as possible and utilize it for the satisfaction of the senses. Srila Shukadev Goswami thus described the activities of the materialistic persons. Nidraya hriyate naktam vyavayena chavavayaha diva charte haya rajan kutumba bharininava. This is a typical example of materialistic persons. At night, they waste their time by sleeping more than 6 hours or by wasting time in sex indulgence. This is their occupation at night, and in the morning, they go to their office or business place just to earn money. As soon as there is some money, they become busy in purchasing things for their children and others. Such persons are never interested in understanding the values of life. What is God? What is the individual soul? What is its relationship with God, etc.? Things are degraded to such an extent that those who are supposed to be religious are also at the present moment interested only in sense gratification. The number of materialistic persons in this age of Kali has increased more than in any other age. Therefore, persons who are interested in going back home, back to Godhead, should not only engage in the service of realized souls, but should give up the company of materialistic persons whose only aim is to earn money and employ it in sense gratification. They should also not accept the objectives of materialistic persons, namely money and sense gratification. Therefore, it is stated, bhakti parishanu bhava viraktir anyatra cha. Bhagavatam 11.2.42. To advance in devotional service, one should be uninterested in the materialistic way of life. That which is the subject matter of satisfaction for the devotees is of no interest to the non-devotees. Simple negation or giving up the company of materialistic persons will not do. We must have engagements. Sometimes it is found that a person interested in spiritual advancement gives up the company of material society and goes to a secluded place, as recommended for the yogis especially. But that will also not help a person in spiritual advancement. For in many instances, such yogis also fall down. As far as jnanis are concerned, generally they fall down without taking shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord. The impersonalists or the voidists can simply avoid the positive material association. They cannot remain fixed in transcendence without being engaged in devotional service. The beginning of devotional service is to hear about the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is recommended in this verse, Vina Harir Guna Piyushapanat. Could everyone repeat? Vina Harir Guna Piyushapanat. That is, one must drink the nectar of the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And this means that one must be always engaged in hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord. That is the prime method for advancing in spiritual life. By the way, what's the prime method, if you're going to tell me in Sanskrit, for advancing in spiritual life? That's a mantra you can go around distributing today to everybody that you meet. In fact, if you're going on book distribution, try telling somebody about that today. They'll be very interested actually to hear that. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also recommends this in Chaitanya Charitamrita. If one wants to make advancement in spiritual life, by great fortune he may meet a bona fide spiritual master and from him learn about Krishna. By serving both the spiritual master and Krishna, he gets the seed of devotional service, bhakti lata bij. And if he sows the seed within his heart and waters it by hearing and chanting, it grows into a luxuriant bhakti lata or bhakti creeper. The creeper is so strong that it penetrates the covering of the universe and reaches the spiritual world and continues to grow on and on until it reaches and takes shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna, just as an ordinary creeper also grows on and on until it takes a solid shelter on a roof. Then it very steadily grows and produces the required fruit. The real cause of the growing of such fruit, which is here called the nectar of hearing the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is to water the creeper of devotional service by hearing and chanting. The purport is that one cannot live outside the society of devotees. One must live in the association of devotees where there is constant chanting and hearing of the glories of the Lord. The Krishna consciousness movement is started for this purpose so that hundreds of ISKCON centers may give people a chance to hear and chant, to accept the spiritual master and to disassociate themselves from persons who are materially interested. For in this way, one can make solid advancement in going back home, back to Godhead. So one can organize one's life throughout the day, morning and evening, or at least have some steady program to hear about the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One of the best ways to drink this nectar is to sing it, because everyone likes to sing songs. The melody, the rhythm, it opens up the heart and mind so that the transcendental vibration can go more deeply within. Therefore, the great devotees, who are also called kavis, they're poets. In fact, there are various kinds of poets in this world, but the kavis are the best. In fact, one of the tests of the kavi, the highest kind of poet, is that the kavi can write a poem that you can read forwards and backwards, and it'll mean the same thing. Can you do that? It's very difficult even to write a few words like that. But if you'll notice in one of the recently published books from the BBT, there are poems written by Rupa Goswami that you can read backwards, forwards, upwards, downwards, around, and so forth. In any case, one of the great poems written by Jayadeva Goswami in the Gita Govinda describes the loving pastimes of Krishna in Vrindavan, and the preface to that Gita Govinda gives us a list of all the various incarnations of the Lord. Now, in the third chapter of the first canon of the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned by Sudha Goswami that by hearing about the incarnations of the Lord in the morning and in the evening, one can become free from all the miseries of life. Let's try it. Pralaya payobdi jale dritava nasi vedam. All together. Vihita vahitra charitra makeda keshavadrita nina sharira jajagadhisha hare Jai Jagadisha Hare, Jai Jagadisha Hare. Shitiriha vipulatare tishtati tava prishte Dharani dharana kina chakra garishtaye Keshavadrita Kurma Sharira Jai Jagadisha Hare Jai Jagadisha Hare Jai Jagadisha Hare Vasati Dashana Shikare Dharani Tava Lagna Shashanika Lanka Kaleva Nimagna Keshavadrita Shukara Rupa Jai Jagadisha Hare Jai Jagadisha Hare Jai Jagadisha Hare Tavakara kamalavare nakamadhuta shringam Dalita hiranyakashi putarubhinga Keshavadrita narahari rupa Jajagadisha hare Jajagadisha hare Jai Jagadisha Hare Chalayasi Vikmane Balima Uta Vamana Pananaka Nirajanita Janapavana Keshavadrita Vamana Rupa Jai Jagadisha Hare Jai Vamana Dev! Jaya Jagadisha Hare Kshatriya Rudhiramaye Jagadapagata Papa Snapaya Sipaya Shishamita Bhavatapa Keshavadrita Bhrigupati Rupa Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Vitrasi Dikshurane Dikpati Kamaniyam Dashamukha Mali Balim Ramaniya Keshavadrita Rama Sharira Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Vahasiva Pushi Vishade Vasanam Jala Dabha Halahati Biti Milita Yamunabham Keshavadrita Haladara Rupa Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Nindasi Yagyavadhe Hashuti Jata Sadaya Ridaya Darshita Pashugata Keshavadrita Uda Sharira Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Lachani Vahani Dhane Kalayasi Karavalam Duma Ketumiva Kimapi Karalam Keshavadrita Kalki Sharira Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Shri Jaya Deva Kaveri Tamudita Mudaram Shrina Sukhadam Shubhadam Bhavas Keshavadrita Dasvidarupa Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare Veja Murara Te Jaganti Vahade Bhugolam Bhubibrate Jam Darayate Balam Chalayate Shatrashayam Kurvate Paulascham Jayate Halakalayate Karunamatanvate Lechan Murchayate Dasha Kriti Krite Krishna.
One more time.
Mechan Murchayate Dasha Kriti Krite Krishna Yatubhyam Nama.
Now hum it. To the end. Ramananda to the last verse. Translation. O Keshava, O Lord of the universe, O Lord Hari, who have assumed the form of fish. No,
Ramananda, the last verse. O Lord Krishna, I offer my obeisances unto you, who incarnate in these 10 forms. In the form of Matsya, you rescue the Vedas. As Kurma, you bear Mount Mandara on your back. As Varaha, you lift the earth on your tusk. As Nisringa, you tear open the chests of the demon Hiranyakashipu. As Vaman, you trick King Bali. As Parushuram, you slay all the wicked Kshatriyas. As Ramachandra, you defeat Ravana, the son of Bulastya. As Balaram, you carry a plow. As Lord Buddha, you show compassion toward all. And as Kalki, you kill the Malechas. Bring the verse back. Lechan muchayate dasha kriti krite Krishnaya tubhyam nama. Tai gaurari bo hari bol hari bon tai gaura hari bo. It's kind of amazing that Krishna gave us the ability to make all kinds of sounds. Just with your own voice box, you can make music. And that music is especially meant for this glorification. That's why Krishna is called Uttama Shloka. And if you align yourself with all these beautiful verses, and then you use your facility for singing, or humming, or saying, the divine syllables in the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, or the various authorized accounts of the pastimes of the Lord, the Ramayana and the Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, then just by that, using what you already have, no other paraphernalia necessary, if you just use that, then you'll come to the highest perfectional stage of life, which is to attain pure love of God. It's there dormant within the heart, and it's reawakened by this transcendental vibration. And as Prabhupada mentions in the purport we just read, it's done in the association of the devotees. And before I move to the next section, we'll take a couple of reflections of what we heard so far. Anything that stuck from the purport or any of the monologue. Yes, Prashant, and then up to Hari Nama Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Thank you for the wonderful lecture. I was just thinking about the introduction that you gave before you got into Bhagavatam, and it had such rich context, and I could relate to that. And couple of keywords that you mentioned, asset, right? At least until a decade ago, I was running after I want to get a house. Let me invest something in stocks, right? And then I was going on to build another asset, and I realized, oh, I lost my stocks, right? I was always in this confusion mode. But then you put forth another sentence which talked about spiritual fortune is the only real fortune. And I was thinking how realistic that word is, right? Because you feel a sense of satisfaction when you get into service, when you try to do, you know, your regular rounds, your singing the songs like we did today, right? So that satisfaction is something which cannot be matched. And the sooner we realize is better, because when it's too late, right, you can't go back and revert things. So thank you for reminding, and it makes us focus that much that, you know, we need to pursue spiritual wealth. Thank you so much.
Yeah, there's a similar way in which one applies the principles of accumulating material and spiritual wealth. In fact, in the Padyavali, it's mentioned that just as a miser counts and recounts his coins, similarly a devotee counts and recounts his verses, How many did I get? And the Goswamis counted, Sankhya Purvakanama Gananati Bikalavasani Kruto. They counted how many times they were performing these devotional acts. They kept track of them. In fact, we know that when Gopinath Patanayaka was placed in the Changa, within that, the story, that there's an account of one of the devotees who was being held and he would chant the Maha Mantra. He didn't have any counter beads, so he'd make a little mark on his arm. He was keeping track how many times he was counting and so forth. And in developing material wealth, there are certain principles that one has to follow. For instance, you have to put away at least 10% of your gross income every month. No matter how much, how many bills you have, you either have to make more money or you have to have fewer expenses, but you have to put away 10% minimum. Then you have to find good investments, and there are principles for investing. One of them is called dollar cost averaging, which means that every month, instead of just putting all your money in the marketplace at once, you put a little bit in at a time, so that when the market is high, you're buying fewer shares, and when the market's low, you're buying more shares, less cost, and every month you put in and the market goes up and down, and over time, through dollar cost averaging, you put all your assets, you've invested in them, and also diversification, and also sticking to your philosophy and not freaking out when the market goes down, because most people buy high and sell low. They panic and they go along with everybody else like lemmings and they sell everything off and then they lose. So I'm just saying that there's sound principles for developing wealth. And in the same way, just as the acharyas, they make these comparisons to material assets and also to material processes. Then in the same way, one can calculate how to regulate one's spiritual life so that one's always taking in these assets. For instance, dollar cost averaging means you have to have a system so that every day you're putting something in. You have to put at least 10% of your overall time into your spiritual life. Prabhupada mentions this in the story of the Prachetas, who stayed underwater for 10,000 years. How long was their lifespan overall? 100,000. How much is that percentage-wise? That's what I thought. And Prabhupada mentions that. If you can use 10% of your life invested in spiritual life, of course, we like 100%, and Krishna asked for 100%. But if you can put in 10% of your gross overall output into devotional service once a day, out of 24 hours, by the way, how long is that? 2.4 hours. Possible? Yes. Not for some people. And therefore, it's not a matter of time, it's taste. And if, however, one develops this habit of taking at least 2.4 hours a day and investing it in a spiritual asset, what's it going to take for you today, Mr. Perkins, to get you into a no-load spiritual mutual fund? Arrange. You have to if you're going to develop material wealth, you have to make an arrangement. You actually have to study the science. You have to meet with a financial advisor. Best if you meet with one that's fee-based, not based on how much they don't take a percentage of what they make from you, so you can be manipulated. There's a whole science to it, and when you do that, when you take help and you follow a system, then over time you'll develop wealth. In the same way, spiritually, you have to take help from somebody who knows how to advise you, and they don't have a vested interest. They simply, out of the goodness of their heart, they're teaching you how to advance, and they teach you the basic principles that you continue no matter what. And even if things look like they're going the opposite direction, you go on chanting, Tate Anukampam Susumikshamanam. This is one of the principles of spiritual investing, how to fill up the heart. Even in whether the market's down or up, you keep investing. That's dollar cost averaging. It's way down, keep buying. And you're crazy. I'm not crazy. I'm following a principle. And similarly in your life, as your life starts to crash in various ways, because it'll appear to be doing that. It's not actually doing it. It's just like when you're going to the Himalaya, you have to go through the foothills. Looks like you're going up and down, but you're actually going up in elevation as you go. But as you go up and down in life, and you keep investing. It's like you're going down fast. You know, grab on. No, keep investing. Keep chanting. Give your 2.4 hours. I can't afford it. The house is flooding. So what? Do your 2.4 hours. You keep chanting. You keep going, whether it's up or down, and you invest in the spiritual market. And you put that asset in your heart. And this is the principle. You never touch the principle when you're investing. You don't take away from your investment. You let it grow over time. And by compounding interest, after some time, even if someone just starts early at a young age and they start following basic principles of wealth building, then later on in life, as it just compounds, they'll be wealthy. And it's like, how'd you do that? Just followed a few basic principles. So the acharyas give us these basic principles. For instance, Rupa Goswami in the Nectar of Instruction tells us a very clear, commonsensical way in which one can develop this spiritual wealth. How much can one develop the wealth? It starts with basic principles. Vacha vegam, manasa krodha vegam, jiha vegam, udarapasta vegam. Start by controlling the urges. And then follow these six items. Avoid these other six items. He tells about six things to avoid, six things to take up. You can put them on your refrigerator. They'll fit. And all you have to do is follow them. These are the basic principles of spiritual investment. And then he says, learn how to associate with devotees in the proper way. Someone was telling me, someone gave a class somewhere recently. I won't mention any names or places, but somebody who wasn't qualified to give class sat down and said, well, I don't offer obeisance to devotees because I don't find anybody qualified. This is not one of the principles of spiritual investing. So one has to get the correct information and invest properly. And as you go through the Nectar of Instruction, you'll find that what happens, your assets grow. You come to the point at the last three verses where you can understand the appearance of the Lord in this world, the places that he visited in Vrindavan become your greatest treasure in life. And then you can understand his personal pastimes in Radhakund, which I'll only say that much about, because unless one is properly invested throughout one's life or for many lifetimes, one has no right to come to that section and delve into it. It comes naturally through the process of developing spiritual wealth. What other insights? Yes.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So you just said it also. The reflection I had as you've been talking is the taste. I've been living in Hoogeveen the last 6 months in Drenthe, the north of Holland, and really went around, and mostly there are churches there, so I started attending some churches, really hungry for bhakti, and there actually is a lot of bhakti in different places, but there's just nothing like sitting in a Bhagavatam class and really hear Prabhupada's commentary, your commentary. So thank you very much. I'm just a poor beggar for just more of this. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I really like the point you made about that we have to collect these treasures in our heart, because it's the only receptacle, the only storage place that will actually sustain. Everything else will be taken from us. This morning we were reflecting about Subhudi Roy, who kind of had it all and then he lost it all to the will of Providence, and he was just collecting dry firewood, and with the proceeds he would serve the Vaishnavas. So it's a very interesting correlation. Thank you.
Thank you. 1, 2, 3. And then Karnath? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then I'm moving on. Okay? Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, you mentioned the experiences from your friend Divyanga Prabhu about the beggar asking hungrily for Bhagavad Gita versus the other person, rich person, discarding it. So I just want to share a similar experience I had in my life. Like several years ago, I was working in a remote forest of India in the state of Jharkhand, and I had the association of the devotees from Mayapur. So one day we decided to go to a prison, to a jail, to distribute books and kirtan and prasadam. So, and that was, jail was like full of all the most dreaded criminals and terrorists, actually. So I would say I was glad to have that opportunity to go to that kind of place, right, and spread the message of Krishna. So something surprisingly happened that it actually motivated us a lot. It was beyond our imagination. We were doing kirtan and distributing prasadam and distributing Bhagavad Gita. One criminal, prisoner, he came and said, "I don't understand Hindi. Can you please give me a Bengali version of Bhagavad Gita?" So we were really impressed by seeing his devotion, his hunger to understand things and to read Bhagavad Gita. And then after a few years, I came to the US and made many friends here in the Bay Area. This one of my friends here, super rich. Example is like when the Apple Watch was launched, he used to wear two watches in his hand, one Apple Watch and a super luxury watch here. So I was talking to him and I told him about Palo Alto program. Harinam invited him and said, "Oh, Palo Alto," and he's supposed to be from the so-called Brahmanic class of India. "Oh, I've seen those guys sitting in Palo Alto." So I could relate that the story of people like how the poor and uneducated and so-called criminal in India was hungry for Bengali version of Bhagavad Gita so that he could understand better versus a super rich Silicon Valley professional just doesn't understand anything.
Nice point. And I know this wasn't what you're saying, but just to make sure that it could go the other way as easily. We've met other people, like for instance, I've met homeless people in Santa Cruz who wouldn't touch a piece of prasadam. And, I've run into very wealthy people who were starving for spiritual life. And oftentimes they say that they have everything and they're not satisfied. And then they are looking for that real asset in life and so forth. So there's no stereotype, that's the point. And it's the prerogative of the teacher of Krishna consciousness who actually goes out and mingles with people and gives them Krishna consciousness to see this for oneself, for themselves, and to realize that bhakti can spring up anywhere. There's a little rock in my backyard, and somehow or other the wind blew a little dirt into one of the crevasses within the rock, and then a year later there was a plant growing out of that. And I was just appreciating that a plant can grow out of a rock if it's given a little bit of facility. A little seed gets in there. So the bhakti seeds, when they spread all over the world, they start to grow in the most unlikely places. And this is a lot of fun, going around spreading bhakti and watching it grow. It brings great joy to the heart, and that's all Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked us to do. In fact, he gave us the greatest occupation, just go out and spread this and watch what happens and take part in watering it. You're next, right?
So Maharaj, I have a reflection, and first I'll read Sundarananda Prabhu's.
Sundarananda Prabhu, wow.
"Thank you for the nice point, Prabhu. Spiritual investment, 10% of your time.
Minimum."
And I was also thinking along the same lines, that the topic of today's class was your heart is a bank, fill it up. And I was thinking, how much can you fill that up? And then we hear that Hari Anant, Hari Katha Anant, so Lord's pastimes are infinite, so how do you get all of them in the heart? And I was reminded of the piglet from Winnie the Pooh that
That's
you mentioned.
Right. We quoted from Winnie the Pooh last week, right during the Sunday program.
And then I was also thinking about
how... Well, can we tell what Piglet said, though?
Oh, the Piglet said that...
Piglet Uvacha.
Yeah, so I don't have the exact words, but the essence is that I have a very tiny heart, but I'm amazed at how much gratitude it can hold inside it. So, and so I was just thinking what you mentioned, that the greed is the only requirement. To how much you will fill, and if you have that greed, then Krishna will actually clear away all the dirt, so that in the heart that you can fill even more inside it.
Yes, and that those who are spreading the Sankirtan movement, they have a built-in meter to detect that. The expert ones, they detect that in people. They can instantly assess how much of a desire does the person have, and to that degree, the person is qualified to take to bhakti. It's as simple as that. And when you see that desire, no matter where it comes from, then that is meant to be fanned. It's a spark. You fan it and make it grow. And then Akurnath, you were next.
I was thinking, at the very beginning of the class, you
talked about... By the way, so good to see you here.
Oh, Hare Krishna.
Welcome, Purna.
I have to come to detest all the material sound vibrations so that I'll always live in the association of the devotees. I was thinking that at the beginning of the class, you mentioned that we have to put ourselves in front of spiritual sound, and that that sound resonates with the soul because it has those qualities of Krishna that also that we have as spiritual souls of Satchitananda, and that tied into the, I don't remember the Sanskrit that we had to say today, but the essence was that Vina, Harer, Yashod, Piyusha, Vanat, or something like that, that we have to relish the glorification of Lord Hari and feel like we can't live without that, and therefore we have to live in the association of devotees.
Yeah, and it's, you know, the metaphor of it being a drink, that something you can actually drink. It's given in the Bhagavatam in many, many places. And you know, just as one's maintaining one's physical body, there's certain things that you have to take in order to maintain the balance of health in your body. You can become anemic if you don't get enough iron, for instance. And if you have a blood test, the doctor will say, okay, you're a little bit low on the, what is it, B12? B12, yeah, B12. You've got to start taking some B12, and you have to drink it. You take it. And so we can also become spiritually anemic if we don't drink enough of this spiritual nectar. And it's also important to put oneself in a situation where one has to do it, because the mind is so obstinate and prone to degradation that if one doesn't arrange ahead of time a way in which to stay on a regular spiritual health regimen, to drink what you're supposed to drink even when you don't feel like it, then the natural tendency will be to drink something else. And what is that? The shastras all say, I drank poison instead. You get like two glasses, and that's how crazy the mind is. There's nectar over here and a glass of poison over here, and the mind's saying, drink the poison. It's like, why would you do that? It's like, I don't know, but just do it. And this is the bent in the material world, to drink more and more poison and concoct newer kinds of poison and different combinations of poison and put new labels on it. So one has to be very vigilant, has to be vigilant to develop a program to drink nectar rather than poison. Yes.
They even have a saying when you go to a bar or something, they say, what's your poison?
That's right. There's a name of a bar somewhere in San Diego. What is that? I forget what it's called. The Dungeon or Hell or something like that. People actually flaunt that. There's songs, I remember, there was a famous heavy metal band that wrote a hit song, runaway song, called Highway to Hell. And, you know, sort of glorifying the you know, like, I don't care what anybody says, I'm going to hell. I'm going to do this, you know. Yeah.
Yesterday I was speaking to a nurse practitioner, and she was advising me that there's a new, some kind of juice bar restaurant or something called Vitality Bowl. But because of her Filipino accent, I thought she was saying fatality bowl.
Very appropriate and altogether possible to arrange such a bowl for one. And here we have the Hellhole Bar. There it is in San Diego, Hellhole Bar. We do our Harinam outside there sometimes. Well, at least they admit it, and they don't try to cover it up. Okay, so a couple points that that relate to the heart. One is in the may I have a Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila, chapter 15, and you might as well bring chapter 12 while you're at it as well. So in the story, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and his wife invite Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to come to their house for prasadam. Such a lovely thing. This is one of the tenets of bhakti, is to take prasadam in the association of devotees. Could you open that, please, to Madhya 15, 272? And there, when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was taking prasadam in the house of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, his son-in-law, Amoga, came and poked his head in the door to watch Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And unfortunately, he had jealousy within his heart. So he was watching Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the most beautiful of all personalities, wonderful sannyasi, there taking prasadam. Then he became critical. And he said, oh, I've heard that Vaishnavs, and particularly Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, eats more than required. And now I see for myself, it's true. And because of that, actually, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was trying to serve prasadam to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, because this is what you do when a Vaishnava comes to your home. You make a nice arrangement, and you serve prasadam. What to speak if the Supreme Personality of Godhead comes. And then he was trying, with half of his body, to block the door and the other half to keep serving. And Amoga kept up his diatribe from the door. So finally, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, the great scholar and then converted into a pure-hearted Vaishnava, picked up a stick and began chasing Amoga, his son-in-law, down the street, trying to beat him. And Amoga was younger. He got away very easily. But then the next day, Amoga contracted cholera. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya quoted a verse that says, what I could not achieve by my own power was achieved by the Gandharvas, which means that you want something to happen, you can't do it yourself, but then by nature it just happens. So he was sort of rejoicing. And then also his wife was, let Sati become a widow, that is the wife of Amoga, meaning let Amoga die. They were so distraught with him. So Amoga went away. He was feeling the effects of this offense he had committed. And when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard about it from Gopinathacharya, he ran to that place where Gopinathacharya was ailing and quickly dying from this cholera, very serious disease, especially in those days. And here we take up at 15.272, where Gopinathacharya informs the Lord that both the husband and wife were fasting and that their son-in-law, Amoga, was dying of cholera. As soon as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard that Amoga was going to die, he immediately ran to him in great haste, placing his hand on Amoga's chest. He spoke as follows, "The heart of a Brahmana is by nature very clean. Therefore, it is a proper place for Krishna to sit." I'll read that again because it's such beautiful poetry. Sahaje nirmale e brahmana hridoy, Krishnera vasite e jogya sthana hoy. The heart of a Brahmana is by nature very clean. Therefore, it is a proper place for Krishna to sit. This is the conception that we keep our heart clean so that Krishna can sit there. Why have you allowed the chandala of jealousy to sit here also? In this way you have contaminated a most purified place, your heart. However, due to the association of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, all your contamination is now vanquished. When a person's heart is cleansed of all contamination, he is able to chant the Mahamantra Hare Krishna. Therefore, Moga, get up and chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. If you do so, Krishna will unfailingly bestow mercy upon you. Purport. By His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki. The Absolute Truth is realized in three phases, impersonal Brahman, Paramatma, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan. All of these are one and the same truth, but Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan constitute three different features. Whoever understands Brahman is called a Brahmana, and when a Brahmana engages in the Lord's devotional service, he is called a Vaishnava. Unless one comes to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his realization of impersonal Brahman is imperfect. A Brahmana can chant the Hare Krishna mantra on the platform of Namabhasa, but not on the platform of pure vibration. When a Brahmana engages in the Lord's service, fully understanding his eternal relationship, his devotional service is called Abhideya. When one attains that stage, he is called a Bhagavata or Vaishnava. This indicates that he is free from contamination and material attachment. Lord Krishna confirms this in the Bhagavad Gita 7:28 altogether. Yesham twantakatam papam jananam punyakarmanam te dvandva mohanir mukta vajante mandradavrataha. Persons who have acted piously in previous lives and in this life, and whose sinful actions are completely eradicated, are freed from the duality of delusion, and they engage themselves in my service with determination. Practical question, how's the temperature in here for y'all? It's fine? Anybody who thinks it's warm, raise your hand. Anyone who thinks it's fine, raise your hand. Okay, it's fine. We can actually see that in this age of Kali, a brahmana may be a very learned scholar, but this does not mean that he is free from material contamination. A brahmana's contamination, however, is in the mode of goodness. In the material world, the three modes are goodness, passion, and ignorance, and all of these are simply different gradations of contamination. Unless a brahmana transcends such contamination and approaches the platform of unalloyed devotional service, he cannot be accepted as a Vaishnava. As an example, as mentioned in the nectar devotion, if one takes the devotional service and thinks that one must also maintain various regulations from the Shruti Shastras, Karmakanda section. For instance, sometimes there's in Karmakanda, there may be a death in the family or something like that, and a priest, Karmakanda priest, may say, okay, don't chant the Mahamantra now for 11 days. And if someone follows that, thinking that those rules and regulations supersede the Vaishnava principle of continuously chanting the holy name of the Lord, this is considered a contamination. And however, the acharyas, Jiva Goswami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, say that if one follows various karmakanda regulations in one's life, but doesn't have faith in them, simply does it because it conforms with the particular custom of the village or the family, that's not harmful. But if one has some abiding faith and thinks, oh, I have to worship certain demigods in order to progress in life and so forth, and puts these above the principles of bhakti, this is considered contamination. Sometimes he imagines a form of the Lord, saguna upasana, but such an attempt is never successful in helping one attain complete realization. The impersonalist may consider himself a brahmana and may be situated in the mode of goodness, but nonetheless, he is conditioned by one of the modes of nature, material nature. This means that he is not yet liberated, for liberation cannot be attained unless one is completely free from the modes. In any case, the Mayavad philosophy keeps one conditioned. If one becomes a Vaishnava through proper initiation, he automatically becomes a brahmana. There is no doubt about it. The Garuda Purana confirms this. Out of many thousands of brahmanas, one may become qualified to perform yajna. Out of many thousands of such qualified brahmanas, one may be fully aware of the Vedanta philosophy. Out of many millions of learned Vedanta scholars, there may be one Vishnu Bhakta, or one devotee of Lord Vishnu. It is he who is most exalted. Unless one is fully qualified, a fully qualified brahmana, he cannot advance in the spiritual science. A real brahmana is never envious of Vaishnavas. If he is, he is considered an imperfect neophyte. Impersonalist brahmanas are always opposed to Vaishnava principles. They're envious of Vaishnavas because they do not know the goal of life. Nate vidu swarta gatim hi Vishnum. However, when a brahmana becomes a Vaishnava, there is no duality. If a brahmana does not become a Vaishnava, he certainly falls down from the brahmana platform. This is confirmed by Srimad Bhagavatam 11.5.3, which is also quoted by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his teachings to Sanatana Goswami, Na bhajantya vijanati stanad brashta padantya daha. We can actually see that in this age of Kali, many so-called brahmanas are envious of Vaishnavas. The Kali-contaminated brahmins consider deity worship to be imaginative Arche Vishnu Shiladir Guru Shru Naramatir Vaishnave Jati Bhuti. Such a contaminated Brahmana may superficially imagine a form of the Lord, but actually he considers the deity in the temple to be made of stone or wood. Similarly, such a contaminated Brahmana considers the Guru to be an ordinary human being, and he objects when a Vaishnava is created by the Krishna consciousness movement. Many so-called Brahmanas attempt to fight us, saying, how can you create a Brahmana out of a European or American? A Brahmana can be born only in a Brahmin family. They do not consider that this is never stated in any revealed scripture. Lord Krishna specifically states in Bhagavad Gita, Chatur Varnyam Mayashrishtam Gunakarma Vibhagasha. According to the three modes of material nature and the work associated with them, the four divisions of human society are created by me. Thus, a Brahmana is not a result of the caste system. He becomes a Brahmana only by qualification. Similarly, a Vaishnav does not belong to a particular caste. Rather, his designation is determined by the rendering of devotional service. Very important to the point of jealousy and material contamination, which is one of the topics for today, because as one's filling up one's heart with spiritual asset, one has to remove the various contaminations in order to make it a worthy place to worship Krishna. And then, after hearing Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and being touched by him, Amoga, who was on his deathbed, immediately stood up and began to chant the holy name of Krishna. Thus he became mad with ecstatic love and began to dance emotionally. While Amoga danced in ecstatic love, he manifested all the ecstatic symptoms, trembling, tears, jubilation, trance, perspiration, and a faltering voice. Seeing these waves of ecstatic emotion, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began to laugh. Amoga then fell before the Lord's lotus feet and submissively said, O merciful Lord, please excuse my offense. Not only did Amoga beg the Lord's pardon, but he also began slapping his own cheek, saying, by this mouth I have blasphemed you. Indeed, Amoga continued slapping his face over and over until his cheeks were swollen. Finally, Gopinathacharya stopped him by catching hold of his hands. After this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pacified Amoga by touching his body and saying, you are the object of my affection because you are the son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Everyone in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house is very dear to me, including his maids and servants and even his dog. And what to speak of his relatives. Amoga always chant the Hare Krishna mantra and do not commit any further offenses. After giving Amoga this instruction, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Sarvabhauma's house. So this is a simple instruction Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives again and again, that is to don't commit any further offenses and go on chanting Hare Krishna. If you do that, you'll be fine. And this is immortalized in the verse of a song by Bhaktivinoda Thakur called Udayurla Anurna. Arunadaya Kirtan. Udilo Aruna Puraba Bhage Dvijamani Gora Mani Jage Udilo Aruna Puraba Bhage Bakata Samua Loya Sate Gela Nagara Braje Tata Tata Bhajaloko Gana Gana Tae Jajeraro Preme Dhala Dhala Sonaranga Charane Nupura Bhaje Mukunda Madhava Yadava Hari Bolina Bolo Revadana Bhori. Miche Nidavashe Gelore Rati Divasha Shari Rasha Je. Ae Mana Dulaba Manavadeho Paya ki koro bhavana ke ho. Ebe na bajile jashoda suta charame pori belaje. Udita tapana hoile asta Dina gelo bole hoi be byasta. Tabe keno ebe alasa hoi Na bhajari doya raje. Jivana nitya jana sa Tahena na vida viparabha. Namashraya kori jatane tumi taka panakaje. Jivera kalyana sadhana kaham Jagate asiye madhuryanam. Avidyati mira tapana rupe Hridgagani viraje. Krishna nam sura koli apan jura bhakati vinora pran. Nam bina kichu nahi ko aro Chora bhuvanam bhaje. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Nitai Gaur Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nitai Gaur Hari Bol. Jai Jai Prabhupad, 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 Jai Jai Prabhupad. Jai Go Premanande Avantika Harmonium for the Madanga players, for the Kowtow players, for the Hare Krishna singers, for the Hare Krishna dancer. Go Premanande Nitai Gaur Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nitai Gaur Hari Bol. Translation, please. Mm-hmm. when a tinge of red on the horizon heralded the sunrise, the jewel of the twice-born Lord Gorasundar immediately awakened. Taking his devotees with him, he went all over the countryside, visiting the towns and villages of Nadia. The madungas resounded. Tatai, tatai, the cymbals chimed in time. In time. And Lord Garanga's footbells jingled as his golden form trembled, slightly in ecstatic love of God. Lord Chaitanya called out to the townsfolk altogether, "You spend your nights uselessly sleeping and your days decorating your bodies. Now just fill your mouths with the vibration of the holy names, Mukunda, Madhava, Yadava, Hari, chanting without offense. You've achieved the rare human body. You do not care for this gift? If you do not serve the darling of Yashoda now, great sorrow awaits you at death. Each time the sun rises and sets, a day passes and is lost. Then why do you remain idle and refuse to serve the Lord of the heart? Understand this essential fact. Life is temporary and full of all kinds of miseries. So make it your only business to take shelter of the holy name and always engage in his service. Desiring to bless all souls, the sweet name of Krishna has descended to the material world and now shines like the sun in the sky of the heart, destroying the darkness of ignorance. Drink the pure nectar of the holy name of Krishna and thus satisfy the soul of Bhaktivinod. There's nothing but the holy name to be had within all the 14 worlds. So in the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, did I get both volumes that I asked for? Madhya 12.134, please. This is it? Oh, I see you had marked it already. It's a very important pastime. All of them are important. In this section of the Chaitanya Charitamrita, the cleansing of the Gundicha temple. And the author, Sri Chaitanya, Srila Krishnas Kaviraj Goswami points out that this cleansing of the Gundicha Mandir, which is the place in which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, where Lord Jagannath goes to reside after the Rath Yatra procession from the Jagannath temple, which is Vrindavan. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes with all his associates and asks the custodian there, the temple commander, if he can have some pots and brooms to cleanse the temple. The temple commander objects, says, "I can't let you clean." And Mahaprabhu said, "This is what we do. Please, let us do this seva." So bring hundreds, thousands of pots, and they bring brooms, and they begin to sweep and cleanse the temple. And they do it again and again and again. And even after the large pieces are taken out of the temple, then there's smaller pieces, smaller pieces. Anybody who knows who cleans, cleaning is one of the most satisfying of all activities. And brahmanas, those who are in the mode of goodness, they're constantly cleaning because this material world's always filling up again and again with dust and dirt. And the heart is similar. And that's what's the comparison is being given here, that you have to constantly and vigilantly clean the heart. Take out the big pieces, but then don't forget the small pieces also. So in the same way as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu cleansed the temple over and over again and then cleansed outside the temple so that no more would blow in. With such care and attention, devotees must also clean their hearts. In this famous purport, Srila Prabhupada paraphrases his spiritual master, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, who talks about the various ways in which the heart can become contaminated, and that there are innumerable kinds of subtle desires that may enter within the heart. For instance, taking up almost three-quarters of the way through, a little more than three-quarters of the way through the purport, he writes, by his practical example, and this is still paraphrase of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has shown us that all the grains of sand must be picked up thoroughly and thrown outside. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also cleansed the outside of the temple, fearing that the grains of sand would again come within. In this connection, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur explains that even though one may become free from the desire for fruit of activity, sometimes the subtle desire for fruit of activity again comes into being within the heart. One often thinks of conducting business to improve devotional activity, but the contamination is so strong that it may later develop into misunderstanding described as kutinati, fault-finding, and pratishtha, the desire for name and fame and for high position, jivahimsa, envy of other living entities, nisharachara, accepting things forbidden in the shastra, kama, desire for material gain and puja, hankering for popularity. The word kutinati means duplicity. As an example of pratishtha, may attempt to imitate Srila Haridas Thakur by living in a solitary place. One's real desire may be for name and fame. In other words, one thinks that fools will accept one to be as good as Haridas Thakur, just because one lives in a solitary place. These are all material desires. A neophyte devotee is certainly to be attacked by other material desires as well, attacked, namely desires for women and money. In this way, the heart is again filled with dirty things and becomes harder and harder, like that of a materialist. Gradually, one desires to become a reputed devotee or an avatar. So this process of investing within one's heart, from verse number Madhya Lila 12:134, indicates that along with placing more assets within the heart, one also has to be careful that one removes the unwanted desires from within the heart. So one's eyes should be trained to spot aparadhas in the seva and in association with devotees. And one can constantly revisit this process to see that I'm not offending devotees. I'm also not offending Krishna in the way that I'm worshiping him. And also in the holy name. We recite 10 offenses in the morning in many of our ISKCON temples. And those are meant to be taken proactively, that I go out to avoid the various offenses. This is the other aspect of investing within one's heart and filling up the heart with assets. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that the bhakti investment is like putting a seed, and it has to be watered. But similarly, as every gardener knows, along with the good seeds come weeds. And some of them are pernicious. There's a certain kind of weed in my backyard. I'm sure it has some purpose somewhere, but not in my backyard. It grows these little, and then it has little pods on top. And if you don't get to them soon enough, if you touch them, they explode. And they shoot seeds all over the yard. It's like one of those landmines you see, where you step on it, and boom! And it's almost embarrassing going around the yard trying to take those out, and they go pop! And then a million seeds fly into the yard. So how do you do it? My gardener taught me. He said you have to go early enough before the seeds become dry, the pods become dry enough so they're spring-loaded, they'll pop open. And a good gardener avoids that because the more you weed, the more seeds go out into the yard if you do it at the wrong time. So vigilant and so well-studied in the science of removing seeds one has to be in order to be a successful gardener. So in a similar way, devotees are vigilant in removing the various desires from their hearts. And we need a couple more hours to go over more of this material. I'll just mention, will I? I won't. I will take reflections at this point. Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you so much for mentioning about cleansing the heart as well as the external surroundings. I just had a question with regards to maintaining external cleanliness. You have quite often focused on this point in many of your lectures. So sometimes I have at least seen in myself, there's a tendency in the mind to dismiss cleanliness as unimportant and maybe focus more on chanting or reading. So how do we deal with that and see even external cleanliness as a service?
Krishna, in the 11th canto of the Bhagavatam, that in order to have the proper environment for cultivating bhakti, one has to be in sattva-gun. And similarly, in the Bhagavad Gita, yesham tvanta katam papam jananam punyakarmanam te dvandva mohanir mukta bhajanti mam drudav. Those who have become free from all sinful reactions, who live a clean life, can easily prosecute the system of bhakti. But if you're contaminated, you can't. Krishna particularly mentions in his talks to Uddhava ways in which to maintain sattva-gun. And he says that one has to keep one's environment clean, one's body clean. He said you have to drink clean water. That would have been good verse when I was in the water business. And there is there are a number of things that he lists that have to be clean and clean and clean. And if you experiment with this, you'll see for yourself. One thing is, if you have a lot of clutter in your environment, it's very hard to concentrate. This is well known in secular society as well. Those who are efficiency gurus will teach that when you're working on a project, you should move in there, put in there. And there's another mantra. I didn't finish that one, but I'll say this one. That a place for everything and everything in its place. This is sattva-gun. You know where it goes. And that's hard because more stuff comes into your life. You go, where does this fit? So I don't know. What are you anyway? I don't know who you are, where you live. I can't get rid of you. It's difficult, but you have to think about it. And when you put everything in its place and have a place for everything, and you declutter your environment and you focus on one thing, you'll find that your mind feels satisfied and very focused. And cleanliness is important for that also, to stay so that we can remain clear and focused. And it is brahmanas. We'll talk about in the context of the ISKCON society. Brahmanas are those who take second initiation. That's not such, just some ritual, but actually one has to come to this point in one's life where one keeps the environment clean. Why? Because we're meant to continually... Brahmanas continually worship Krishna. It's not that they do it sometimes and not other times. And when you're doing that, you always have to stay in a clean state, in mind and body. Your clothes have to be clean. Watch a Brahmana sometimes and you'll see they're always attending to Krishna one way or the other, either in hearing and chanting or worshiping the deity. One way or another, they're connected to Krishna. This is the Panchachuki process. It's from morning to night. From the second you step out of your bed in the morning, you're saying a mantra for purification. First thing you should say, Krishna, Krishna, just like Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. And then there are mantras that, oh Mother Bhumi, please forgive me for stepping on your surface. You come, you land on the floor with your left foot. Then you offer obeisance to your spiritual master. Then you say, Jayati Jana Nivaso Deviki Janmavaro Yaruvari Parishad Swara Dobira Asyana Dharma. And then there are mantras, brushing your teeth, mantra for stepping in the shower. Constantly, you'll notice in the padatis we have, there are mantras for everything, for taking Sharanamrita, for this and this and that. The Panchatriki is a way in which we stay constantly connected with the deity. This is our Vaidhi Bhakti process. We're constantly worshiping the deity according to the rules of the scripture. And when you do that, you can stay in a clean state of mind according to the acharyas, especially Jiva Goswami, who mentions this in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, to chant Hare Krishna. Some people just say, well, why not just chant Hare Krishna? Why this other stuff? All right, go ahead, do it. Let's see you. Let's see you, Krishna. You have to have both things going in your life. You have to have this momentum of keeping clean and being in contact with the deity, whether directly or indirectly through the Panchatriki process and chanting Hare Krishna. Therefore, we have these two initiations. One is accepting the Harinam Maha Mantra and a new name. And this is mentioned by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his essay, Pancha Samskar, in which he describes the progressive path leading ultimately in initiation to this yoga, which is worshipping the deity. So it's extremely important to stay clean. Okay, you had your hand up earlier, and then we'll go back to Hari Vamsha.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. I have a comment and a question. My comment is, I really love the purport that talks about Chaturvarnya Maya Srishtam Guna Karma Vibhagasha, where, when I got to Krishna consciousness, I remember that my parents were, they couldn't even imagine, because I'm from so-called a Brahmin family, my spiritual master is somebody who is American. So they took time for them to realize that many of the disciples of Prabhupada actually knew so much more in Krishna, about real life than, my parents felt that. And my dad would quote and show videos to my other family members. You know what? They do so much more than what we actually know and do. So I just wanted to comment on that. And the question I had is, in the beginning you were mentioning that, when we have time, we should not spend on other stuff. So, when kids ask us these questions, like they have to do so much study at school and they have so many things to prepare, how would we tell, because, having raised them, and since they have been exposed to Krishna consciousness at their birth, they would ask, what am I going to do learning all this so much in detail? I should probably be doing more, less of this and more of Krishna consciousness. So how do we answer that question?
Yukta hara viharasya, yukta cheshtasya karmasu, yukta swapna vabodasya, yogo bhavati tuka. Krishna doesn't advocate anything fanatical in the Bhagavad Gita or any of his other teachings. Rather, he mentions, first of all, from the Bhagavad Gita, that one should be yukta, that is, properly engaged in a balanced way. And that's, there are various ways to be engaged throughout the various phases of one's life. Paramahamsa stage at the end of one's life, one has a license to not do anything else except chant Hare Krishna. And rightly so. And it's not something that's taken easily. As Prabhupada mentioned, those who imitate Haridas Thakur and simply go off before they're qualified. Even in Ashtanga Yoga, you can't start sitting and meditating until you've done Yam Ni. Because if you sit down, what are you going to do? Get back up again. And where are you going to go? To 7-Eleven. Because that's what's in your mind and heart. And until that's purified, you really can't do anything. And therefore, Krishna talks about how to engage oneself properly throughout the different phases of one's life. And so there are times in which one has to do one's particular duty. As a kid, you got to go to school, you got to learn things. But at the same time, you have to have your quota of being engaged in devotional service. And the best thing to do is dollar cost average. Find out what you can practically do over a long period of time without wavering, and keep investing. And then when you get more, Krishna tells this to Arjuna, to Uddhava, tavat karmana kuravita nan nirvidyeta yavata matkata shravanadalva najayate, that before you've fully awakened the taste for hearing and chanting about me, you have to continue with your regular duties according to the Varna Ashram. And at the same time hear and chant, but when it's awakened, then you have the full permission and stop you to hear and chant because you have that qualification. Hari Vamsha, and then back to Akurnath Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for a wonderful class. I've always liked your analogy about gardening and how it pertains to our spiritual life, the positive aspect of watering and the weeding aspect. Now we get this nice analogy about the bank and the investment. So I was thinking how a person may have billions of dollars, but then he may develop a bad habit of just leaking out that money due to investment in high risk, no return or negative return investments. So I was thinking similarly, we may perform devotional service for many, many years and chant nicely also, but then we develop big holes of anarthas. So whatever we can just drains out. So thank you.
Yes, sometimes sports stars are notorious for losing all their money. Mike Tyson was a famous boxer. He got pulled over. He was driving his Rolls Royce home, which is, how much does that cost? Anyone? You don't have one? Okay. Rolls Royce, how much? It's a lot. I mean, they could be upwards towards 750,000. Do you know how much a Rolls Royce costs? Rolls Royce car?
There's cars that are worth a lot more than Rolls Royces.
How much is more, Lou, worth more?
Like a Bugatti.
Oh, really? All right. Well, I'm outdated. But in any case, he was driving his Rolls Royce home. At least it wasn't a Toyota. And the police pulled him over for a traffic violation, and he said, here, just take the car. He walked away. And, you know, the reports after, he was earning $20 million, $30 million, $40 million per fight. And then he was broke. And there are many stories like this. So people just squander their wealth. So along with wealth building, you have to be very careful in the process. Don't become whimsical. And just extend your, take for granted the asset that you've been given. And even if you got a small investment in bhakti, just a small amount to start with, if you're careful with it and you protect it and you let it grow with compound and interest by not making offenses, by being very humble all the time, then it'll grow into something and people say, how'd you get like this? You were just a little guy. And now look at you. And it's like, it's by the investment process. As they say, a big shot's just a little shot who keeps on shooting, right? So, Akurinath.
I just, when we were talking about giving up material duties and or, you know, when you're advanced enough, it reminded me of a story Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj told me about his own life, that he was a brahmachari. He didn't take sannyas until after Srila Prabhupada passed away. But he was serving Srila Prabhupada as a brahmachari, and then his father passed away. And there was a lot of pressure on him. He was the only son, and there was a lot of pressure on him from his family that he had to come back to Manipur to do the funeral. And Srila Prabhupada wouldn't let him go. And Srila Prabhupada told him, you've been with me so long and you still don't understand. You should stay serving with me. So it made an impression on me that even though, you know, from an ordinary perspective of Dharma, it would be very important for him to go, but because of his
service. An interesting principle that can be discussed also, because there may be various incidents. In the Sri Bhakti Siddhanta Vaibhav, the author points out histories in the life of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, whose disciples would encounter similar situations. Parent would die, something would happen, and then they say, oh, you come home. Mostly there were brahmacharis and sannyasis staying with him. In some cases, he allowed them to go home if he understood that it would cause such a disturbance in the family that he didn't, that it would be more trouble than if he stayed back. So he would allow them in certain cases. And some people hid, and they just, you know, they couldn't be found, things like that. I remember when I first joined the temple, I had this conception of cutting off all my family ties. So my father would come by to see me at the temple, and I'd hide. And when the temple president, who was Nalini Kantapur at the time, found out, he became furious with me. And he said, your father's coming here to see you, and you hide? This is, to me, I thought I was being very spiritual. But I learned something about that. You know, so the point is extremely well taken. I mean, it's an important principle, but it has to be applied according to certain circumstances. There's the anecdote about a person drowning, and Rupa Goswami's asked, do you save him or do you leave him or whatever? And Rupa Goswami points out that if a Vaishnava is callous and just says, he's not his body, let him drown, well, the general people think also. There's a story in Australia in the early days. People didn't like the devotees very much because they were so different. And then there was this burning building. I think it was a nunnery. And the devotees were doing the Rath Yatra, so they saw this burning building in the tree, and they went over with the canopy from the Rath Yatra cart, and they held it out, and the nuns jumped out and were saved. And then the devotees were national heroes that you just see. They came and saved these nuns and so forth. It's not, you know, the business of devotees to go around saving people, something like that, as their primary interest in life. But when there's an opportunity, they may rise to the occasion. And similarly, when the general principle is we're not obligated for these various ceremonies and things like that, especially if you're with Prabhupada. But there may be certain circumstances when it becomes a preaching opportunity also. For instance, a lot of our devotees go to not only funerals, but also weddings and all these kinds of things, and then they come back and report how many books they distributed. It's like, yeah, that was a good funeral. We did like about 200 books. And that is a good funeral. Otherwise, people go there and they say, oh, you know, I'm going to be renounced from now on, and 3 days later, they're back at it again. But if they get a Bhagavad Gita when they're in that state, then they become benefited. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur points out in Jiva Dharma that actually householders, grihasthas, can do more preaching than sannyasis, because sannyasis are restricted about where they can go. Really shouldn't go to a lot of things. They're socially dead. They're supposed to commit social suicide when they take sannyas. If that's it, you're not obligated to go to anything. But grihasthas are supposed to. So in the name of going to all these things, we do a lot of books every year, right, Malini? Yeah, it's pretty big. So utility is possible in that. So today we talked about how the heart is a bank. Fill it up. And there are ways to fill it up that are very practical and easy that we can do on a regular basis. And not only that, we should become greedy for it. Just as a materialist wants to fill up his or her bank account and become richer and richer, a devotee also should this impetus. I quoted from Rupa Goswami saying that this is the main means for advancing in spiritual life. That is having greed for devotional service, and one should run, not walk, to get it. And then we talked about how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pointed out that the heart is a place in which one should install the deity of Krishna and should keep it very clean, shouldn't keep jealousy there. And we heard from Srimad Bhagavatam about how one should arrange one's life so that one can constantly drink the nectar of Krishna's pastimes and his holy name. We sang a couple songs. We spent some time here. Well used on Saturday morning, don't you think? Yes. We filled it up. We filled it up as much as we could. If we do that constantly, then life goes by, the different eras of one's life goes by, and one will notice that one is different. Somehow or other, that investment grows. Just as when you invest and you don't with it too much, you let it grow, it'll compound and it'll grow into something that's like, wow, how'd you get all that money? It's like, I just followed a few basic principles. So in the same way, we can do that in our bhakti process. Gaur Premanande Haribo. Nitai Gaura Haribo. 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 Nitai Gaura Haribo. Nitai Gaura Haribo, 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 Nitai Gaura Haribo. Vanchakalpa Durvishcha Kripa Sindhaveva Cha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo.